He shone a light onto a prism, and through the prism onto a screen where it split up into the colours of the spectrum. Now, this in itself wasn't new, but the received wisdom at the time was that the prism made the spectrum. But Newton thought differently.
Taking another prism, he tried to split the rays of coloured light again, but this time nothing happened.
Newton had uncovered a fundamental truth about light. He'd discovered that white light isn't pure, but is made up of all the colours of the spectrum.
But this was just the beginning. Newton had tackled the problem of colour through experiment and reason. But as he sketched out the different angles of the refracted colours, he began to wonder if mathematics alone might help him to solve even greater problems. The natural world, he began to realise, might unfold from simple rules and patterns. Perhaps mathematics was at the centre of every question he asked. And now, Newton was about to ask the biggest question of all.
Newton had started to think about the invisible attraction that draws all objects to the ground. And as he gazed up at the stars, he began to speculate that this same attraction might control everything in the universe.
When Newton watched the comet cross the sky in 1664, he too was mesmerized. He stayed up night after night making notes. He began to wonder, if mathematics could help explain all natural phenomena, could it help explain the comet in the sky?
The comet had captured the imaginations and the curiosity of the greatest minds in Britain. But would it be Hooke and Wren at the Royal Society, or Newton working alone in Cambridge, who could explain the mysteries of the comet, and with it the laws that govern the universe? By the summer of 1666, the new science was getting into its stride. In London, the Royal Society was now producing a monthly scientific journal. Hooke's microscope had opened up an incredible new world. Boyle's air pump had shown that without air, we cannot live. But there was something much bigger that still fascinated and baffled the young minds. Wren, Hooke, and Boyle were all asking the same questions. Were the heavens governed by mathematical laws? And could they discover them? Little did they know, something much closer to home was about to take their attention.
The Great Fire of London burned for 4 days and 3 nights before it finally burnt itself out, one block away from the Royal Society, where Robert Hooke could have seen the flames. In Oxford, Christopher Wren saw the sky glowing red in the east and recognised a God-given opportunity. He was inspecting the ruins while the embers were still hot. More than 12,000 homes were burnt to the ground. Three-quarters of the city was destroyed. For London, it was a tragedy. For the scientists, it was a golden opportunity. Wren saw his chance, and within days he presented personally to the king his plans for a new city. His great vision was never fully accomplished, but nevertheless, with Hooke as his right-hand man, he created and designed some of the most ambitious and innovative buildings that London had ever seen. Buildings fit for a new scientific age. St. Paul's, with its astonishing unsupported dome, raised nearly 300 feet from the ground, was totally unlike anything ever seen before in England. A triumph of converting pure geometry into mechanics. The Royal Observatory in Greenwich, designed with the sole aim of pursuing astronomy. And for Robert Hooke, the rebuilding of London provided his biggest scientific opportunity so far.
And here are his plans. It's a 200-foot parallax telescope designed to detect the tiny differences between what you see in different parts of the Earth's orbit around the Sun. And amazingly, it's still here, right in the heart of the city of London.
At 61 metres, the monument, as it came to be known, is the tallest stone column in the world. Hooke hoped that its size would enable him to get new measurements of the stars.
Well, here I am at the base of the tower, which means the eyepiece end of Hooke's telescope. The eyepiece was actually down in the basement,
where Hooke himself actually lived for a while the tower was being built. And that's where he would have lain underneath the eyepiece, which would have been a little lens in which he would have looked up like that. Right at the far end of the tower would have been the objective lens.
Something like this, right at the top. And the two lenses together, the eyepiece down below and the objective lens at the top, constituted this gigantic telescope.
The idea was that a telescope of this size would allow Hooke to see more clearly than anyone had seen before.
Trouble is, a telescope this long has got to be very, very steady indeed in order to do its job. And a tower this long is not going to be sufficiently steady, so it didn't work.
For all his efforts, the giant monument had taken Hooke no closer to solving the puzzles of the heavens.
As the decade drew to a close, the search to understand the nature of this mysterious force holding the universe together dominated the scientific landscape. At the Royal Society in London, they studied star charts, revised mathematical calculations, and made wild speculations, but the answers eluded them.
Isaac Newton was becoming an increasingly eccentric figure, wandering the college with his hair uncombed and his shoelaces untied. He gave lectures, but few students showed up, and he would often find himself speaking to an empty room.
In his ivory tower in Cambridge, Isaac Newton wasn't immune to news from the capital. He'd read Hooke's micrographia, scribbling notes in the margin. He'd heard how Boyle's air pump had caused a stir at the Royal Society. And he realised that if his genius was to be recognised, then London was the place to be.
He was confident that they would be bowled over by his theory of light and his new mathematics.
So, for the first time, he introduced himself to the Royal Society by writing a letter with his characteristic arrogance, in which he said he had made the oddest, if not the most considerable, detection that had hitherto been made in the operations of nature.
When Hooke read Newton's letter, he was furious. He was convinced that Newton had stolen his ideas from the micrographia.
Newton acknowledged that he had been influenced by Hooke's ideas, but he insisted that he'd turned them into a proper scientific theory by giving them a mathematical proof. He declared that mathematics would reveal a world beyond the power of the microscope and the telescope. And he jibed at Hooke, belittling his contribution. "If I've seen further," he wrote, "it's by standing on the shoulders of giants." Ostensibly a nod to the ancients, but also possibly a reference to Hooke's small stature and crooked shoulders.
Hooke took offence and broke off communication. It was a disaster. Hooke had spurned the one man with the mathematical talent to help him understand the laws of the universe.